there's always this argument that goes on about whether or not building a truly sustainable building costs more than building a building that's not sustainable. Well, I think that argument is almost gone role reversal now, because if you haven't got a sustainable LEED building, you aren't going to find a tenant to go into it. So the question is almost irrelevant. However, if you plan early, and it's all about planning early, writing a clear brief that you want to have a sustainable building, you want to run the building over the period of its lifetime in a sustainable manner, then the costs are actually much reduced. If, on the other hand, you come and say, I want a sustainable building at day one, but I'm not interested in the running cost, that's where the cost of the building can increase by 3 to 5% for building a sustainable building. But you have to look at it over the longevity of the building.
And if you take all those investments into account, and especially all the material and all the energy into account, then you can better decide, was this really a good building, or was it just very cheap to make a building that works according to the standards that we have today. And we think it's important that you really look at that ownership role, because all those costs and all that energy in effect has to be paid, and it's will be put in the environment. So if you look at that total life cycle cost, yeah, you get a far better price for a square meter than you would do in a traditional building.
That example of Opera is what is now beginning to be rolled out by a lot of developers, because people are now realising that actually we've got to let these buildings, we're going to have to upgrade them from a sustainable point of view as well as a visual point of view. And people are now learning how to do that, and I think these are good examples of how the business is evolving.
Traditionally, you would have a building and the tenant will pay the energy bill. And as long as the tenant accepts the standard of the building, the landlords could argue, why bother? Yeah, because I get a return for my investment and the tenant pays the electricity bill, and hopefully they will use as little as possible, which is best for the climate, and it's best for the tenant's energy bill. That sounds very logic, but it hasn't worked, because then the tenant can say, well, we want to reduce the energy level, but it's not possible because it's not in the building specs. So therefore you need, what can be learned is that the best projects are the projects where the landlord and the tenant worked very closely on this topic from the start. The best examples, and also in this year's prize, are the examples where an owner-occupier or a big tenant takes a vision of 15 or 20 years, and then you can really invest in what's better for the building. And of course, if those buildings will be empty in 15 or 20 years, you have a great building still, because all those investments are already made. But you need a driver, and you really need the tenant involved from the start.
In terms of feasibility of a building, in terms of how you actually develop that building from the outset to how you run that building, have always been two separate things, but now they're integrated, and integration's a great thing in any form of world. The development in sustainability has just been incredible. It's, you know, it's gone like that and continues to do so. What we'll find over the next few years is a lot of people will have reached a plateau and won't go beyond that. But what we're looking for with these awards is the people that have reached that plateau and actually reset the benchmarks. And I think that's what we're really looking for in who's going to win these awards.